सर्वेभ्यः शुभसन्ध्या ए वेरी गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू अहम निवेदनं करोमि भवतः चरवाणी मोबाइल फोन कृपया निशब्द मोड में रख दीजिए कृपया भवतः चरवाणी साइलेंट मोड रख दीजिए सो अहम स्वागतं करोमि सर्वेभ्यः संस्कृत क्लब आईआईटी रुर्की इज ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस गेस्ट लेक्चर I must say it's the first guest lecture. This is the second activity. The first activity started on 10th of March, Sanskrit Sambhashana Shibiram, spoken Sanskrit classes, a unique way of teaching by which one can learn within 10 days conversational Sanskrit. No writing part, only by listening and conversating. This 10 days this classes will be held thanks to Uttarakhand Sanskrit Vishwavidyalayam. So it will go up to 20th of March. The venue is Department of Management Studies, first floor, lecture room 3. Around 60 students and 10 faculty are attending. I sincerely request you to visit these classes once, at least for 5 minutes. And the valedictory function of these classes will be on 20th of March at 6:30 at the same venue. So before introducing the today's guest speaker, aham nivedanam karomi Deepika Bhagini Phula Samuham Ekavaram Dattum to present a bouquet to the guest speaker, Professor Ramasubramanian. So I request few students of IIT Roorkee who are active participants of spoken Sanskrit class to sing a group song in Sanskrit which emphasizes the significance of conversation in Sanskrit. Brajendra and his team.
Namo nama. Pathat Sanskritam, vadat Sanskritam, lasatu Sanskritam chiram gihe gihe cha punarapi. पठत संस्कृतं वदत संस्कृतं लसतु संस्कृतं चिरं गृहे गृहे च पुनरपि ज्ञान वैभवं वेदवाङ्मयं लसति यत्र भवभयापहारि मुनिर्विराजितं कीर्तिराजिता यस्य प्रणयनात् व्यास भास कालिदास वान मुख्य कविभिः पठत संस्कृतं वदत संस्कृतं लसतु संस्कृतं चिरं गृहे गृहे च पुनरपि स्थानमूर्जितं यस्य मन्वते वाग्विचिन्तिका हि वाक्षु यस्य वीक्ष्य मधुरतां यद्विना जना नैव जानुते भारतीय संस्कृतिं सनातना विदाम्बरा पठत संस्कृतं वदत संस्कृतं लसतु संस्कृतं चिरं गृहे गृहे च पुनरपि जयतु संस्कृतं संस्कृतिस्तथा संस्कृतस्य संस्कृतेस्य प्रणयना च मनुकुलं जयतु संस्कृतं जयतु मनुकुलं जयतु जयतु संस्कृतं जयतु जयतु मनुकुलं पठत संस्कृतं वदत संस्कृतं लसतु संस्कृतं चिरं गृहे गृहे च पुनरपि
नमो नमः
बहु धन्यवादः ब्रजेन्द्र अमेय दीपिका तुलसी च सर्वेभ्यः बहु धन्यवादः गीतं गायन्तुं So after this song of Patata Samskrutam and Vadata Samskrutam, so let me introduce you today's guest speaker, Professor Ramasubramanian. He is working in the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences at IIT Bombay. Besides his bachelor's in engineering and master's in Sanskrit, he holds a doctorate in theoretical physics. In 2008, he has been conferred the prestigious award of Maharshi Badarayana Vyas Samman by the President of India in recognition of the outstanding research work done by him to the process of synergy between modernity and tradition. The award is given to young scholars of Sanskrit in the age of 30 to 40 years who have made a breakthrough in the interdisciplinary research. His work on Tantra Sangraha has been brought out jointly by Hindustan Book Agency and Springer in 2011. Currently, he is authoring a couple of monographs and textbooks on Indian astronomy and mathematics. He is one of the authors who prepared the explanatory notes of the celebrated work Ganita Yukti Bhasha, Rationals in Mathematical Astronomy, which brings out the seminal contributions of the Kerala School of Astronomers and Mathematicians in the field of mathematical analysis. This book was published by Hindustan Book Agency, New Delhi in 2008 in two volumes and has been reprinted by Springer in 2009. So besides this, on behalf of IIT Roorkee, thank Professor Ramasubramanian for his contribution in establishing this Sanskrit club at IIT Roorkee to give a push on Sanskrit at IITR to look into the aspects of what can be done so that science and technology embedded in Sanskrit can be utilized in places like IIT Roorkee. So sarvebhyah vinatam karatu. Swagatam karotu adhya atithi bhashana karta Professor Ramasubramanian.
सर्वेभ्यः अत्र समागतेभ्यः छात्रेभ्यः अन्येभ्यः अध्यापकवर्गेभ्यः अथ च संस्कृत अनुरागिभ्यः मदीयान् प्रणामान् आदौ निवेद्य यथा गीते वदतु संस्कृतं पठतु संस्कृतम् इत्युक्तम् तदनुरीत्या मया इदानीं संस्कृते भाषणम् आरब्धम् इतः परं तु आङ्ग्लभाषया एव गच्छामि चिन्ता मास्तु ओके सो नमस्कार ऐ एम रियली डिलाइटेड दैट एन एक्टिविटी ऑफ दिस काइंड इज टेकिंग प्लेस इन आईआईटी आई हैव बीन इन आईआईटी ऑफ कोर्स बॉम्बे फॉर द पास्ट मोर देन अ डीकेड बट आई डोंट सी दिस काइंड ऑफ एंथुसियाज्म टू प्रमोट संस्कृत स्टडीज काइंड ऑफ अ थिंग विच आई हर्ड फ्रॉम So I am thankful to him for having invited me. And the topic which I chose here was to primarily convey you that certain aspects which are considered to be so crucial for the investigation that we carry out in science and engineering, which has been produced in various civilizations, have not come to light. But for the contributions which have been made by a small group of people in the European continent. Now, I'm making this statement as a preface in order to establish certain point which I want to convey as we progress through the lecture. I'm not trying to, first of all, I would like to make it very clear that there is no need to extrapolate anything and then say that string theory is there in Veda. Okay, so let us not make any claims of that type. If we do such things, then it amounts to trying to demean both modern science as well as Veda. So we have to be very clear about it. On the other hand, we also have to be extremely clear that we understand what has been stated in the text in the light of the cultural background, in the light of the context in which it was discovered by his people. So with these few words, let me get into this topic. The Indian cement calculus. Calculus, I need not elaborate too much on that because we have been using it for quite a long time and all of us are engineers as well as scientists. So it has to do with the notion of moving from finite to infinite. It has to do with moving from discrete to continuous. It has to do with discussing things in an instantaneous fashion. So all these things are considered to be fundamentals, okay, on which the calculus is sort of built. What was the motivation for people to arrive at these kinds of notions which are extremely important? This varies from civilization to civilization, and in particular in Indian context, I just want to tell a couple of words. People have been seriously interested in calculating the planetary positions. When I say planetary positions, you need not immediately jump into the context of astrology. It has nothing to do with that. The time that we have today, the division of time, whether it is Masa, whether it is Tithi, whether it is Patra, whether it is various other events, or for instance the calculation of eclipses, all of them are crucially dependent upon the instantaneous motion of moon and the sun. So when you say Naraka Chaturdashi, when you say Ram Navami, when you say any other festival, you have to decide at which point of year you are going to celebrate. So in order to do this, you need to know precisely where the position of the sun and the moon are. Forget about all this. Just imagine this kind of awful event which is happening in the skies. So the event of eclipses. Suppose somebody is curious to find out. So how do we go about doing this? So we need to know exactly what is the latitude of the moon. We need to know exactly what is the longitude of the moon. We need to know exactly what is the rate at which the moon and the sun are moving. So unless we know this, it is impossible for anyone to come up with a reasonably accurate calculation of predicting eclipses. So given that these people have been doing all this for ages, so was there relevant mathematics which they were practicing or not is the issue. So this is all I am going to establish today. And given that, I mean, we can answer ourselves whether a calculus was discovered here or elsewhere. Okay, so this is all it is. And the most crucial notion that actually distinguishes what has been practiced yearly and what has been practiced after the Renaissance, particularly in the Western tradition, is the notion of zero and infinity. Archimedes was, of course, one of the greatest mathematicians, so about whom we can see a lot of literature. And the claims which have also been made that Archimedes invented sort of calculus. So this was in connection with, obviously, in connection with the area and volume which he was trying to determine of various kinds of solids. So he had to obviously split the area or volume into tiny pockets and then sum up. Right? Obviously, summing up has to do with integration in some sense. And splitting into various parts has to do with something called differentiation. Okay? So we just keep this in mind. So people made a claim that he was the discoverer of calculus, but then it was sort of dismissed off because certain notions were not present. The most important thing of them was the notion of limit, which I will come to a little bit later. And then we move on to the other two names. So the moment we hear the word calculus, the two names that spring up into our mind is Newton and Leibniz. So let us see what their contributions were and whether the contributions which have been recognized as the single contributions of Newton was present here or not. So this is another thing which I want to sort of tell you. The way they arrive at it are quite different. So keep this in mind. And the binomial series expansion and the derivation, I just want to give you a flavor of how they have been demonstrating their results, which are considered to be signal achievements in the Renaissance period. So that is what I would discuss when I talk about the Madhava series for pi and the derivation. And the next item is derivation of end correction terms. So these end correction terms, they have coined the word Antya Samskara. You know Antya Samskara? So which is done for all our mortal bodies. But here they have chosen this equation. This equation rather which equates pi with a certain interesting series. This series is known by the name Grigori-Leibniz series in modern terminology. is basically a very beautiful series, 1 minus 1 by 3 plus 1 by 5 minus 1 by 7 and so on, it goes to infinity, and it is this which actually gives you the value of pi, right? So pi is a beautiful geometric quantity, the ratio of circumference to the diameter, and we were able to find out a beautiful equation, and Leibniz for actually inventing this was praised this high by the mathematicians of those period. So this is a very interesting series, and this has been beautifully couched. I gave the title, Did the Indians Invent Calculus? So Anil added couching calculus in prose and poetry, okay? So let me just give you the verse. So the verse is, Vyase Vajinihate Rupadhate Vyasasagaravihate Tri Sharadi Vishama Sankhya Bhaktam. You know Vishama Sankhya? Vishama Sankhya is odd number. Bhaktam means divided. So what it says is, Vishama Sankhya Bhaktam. In this series, all the odd numbers appear in the denominator, bhaktam. Rinam swam prathakramat kurya. Rinam is minus, swam is addition. So it is plus minus, it is not a trading series. It's a very beautiful series. It actually connects so the pi with the rational quantities. So here, so we will discuss how this series, all of you would know, is an excruciatingly slowly converting series. If you were to determine the value of pi using this series, then I don't know even whether God will be able to do, because the number of terms that you have to calculate is almost, see, suppose you want to get 4 decimal places correct, you have to calculate some 10,000 plus terms. If you have to be correct up to 6 decimal, then you have to calculate some 10 million terms in the series. Who will be able to add and subtract and do all this business? But Madhava having invented this series, which is actually, which may look like a useless series as far as the value of pi is concerned, he found a certain device, a very special technique by which he will be able to convert the slowly converting series into a very fast converting series, and by choosing some 50 terms in the series, in the converted series, you will be able to get the value of pi correct to almost 10 to the power, almost correct to 11 decimal places. So this is something which is remarkable, I would say, when one thinks of the development of analysis, what we call today. So you analyze a certain series and try to turn that into a completely different series, and he has worked out in a way that you can keep on increasing the level of accuracy. With 50 terms, you will be able to get 10 to the power up to 11, 10 to the minus 11 accuracy, okay? With the 50 terms again, you can even get to 10 to the power minus 13 if you move on to higher orders of correction. So this is what I mean by this Antya Samskara. I just quickly move on to the, then finally, I will make a few observations based on the observations which have been made by some of the Fields medalists like David Mumford or Manjul Bhargava. I saw a certain quotation which was there in the screen. So this is the idea. As I was mentioning, it starts with primarily calculating the astronomical phenomena accurately. And what is the connection? These are the signal achievements which have been made. So we have the sine series equation number 1 in the form of verse. Then the other series, Grigori-Leibniz series, which I just quoted the verse, this is also given in the form of verse. And the third one is the derivative of sine inverse function. And this again appears in the form of verse. Okay? So these are all very interesting results which have been presented by the Kerala mathematicians who were flourishing between 14th and 16th centuries. The equation 4 that you find here basically is an expression for the longitude of planets. So there you find the sine function appearing, sine inverse function appearing and so on. If you were to determine the longitude precisely, then you should have a certain mechanism by which you will be able to compute the sine function and sine inverse function precisely. Without that, obviously you will not be able to find out. Without that, obviously you will not be able to predict any events accurately. So this is the drive which people had, the motivation which made them to come up with better and better approximations for sine as well as certain other things. So this is all used not only in astronomical computation but in various social and religious functions that we do. So Muhurta, Lagna, etc. for various events that we primarily deal with in our day-to-day life. So all of them are dependent upon the accuracy with which these are determined. The essence of calculus, as I was mentioning, is primarily the ability to handle these infinitesimals. So this comes up as a bundle with the notion of limit. So you think of a small strip, you want to keep on dividing, and then you say delta x tending to 0. As it tends to 0, obviously the number of segments is going to increase to infinity. So the notion of infinity, the notion of zero, and the notion of limit, all of them actually come up with a kind of a bundle. So if you untie them, all the three will sort of open up. So this you have to keep in mind. Okay. What prevented Greeks from discovering this? In fact, Archimedes has worked out very brilliant ways of finding out the area of various types of complicated objects. There is an interesting book which I came across, and the title of the book is Zero. Okay? So, uske baad foran dalke unhone kar diya, a biography of a dangerous idea. You look at the footnote. See, this is by Charles Siffey. The biography of a dangerous idea. Why does he call so? I mean, this number zero behaves in a completely different way compared to the other numbers. So it sort of collapses everything to one point, or it sort of blows out everything. So this is what it does. And therefore, a very interesting thing. There he makes certain observations. So this is relevant to us. Greeks could not do this neat little mathematical trick. They didn't have the concept of limit because they didn't believe in zero. The terms in the infinite series, etc., okay, they pondered over the concept of void but rejected zero as a number, and toyed with the concept of infinite but refused to allow infinity. Numbers that are infinitely small and infinitely large, so anywhere near the real of numbers, okay. This is the biggest failure to Greek mathematics, and it is the only thing that kept them from discovering calculus. On the other hand, what was the scenario here? He says, unlike Greece, India never had the fear of infinite or why? If you need to embrace them, Indian mathematicians did more than simply accept zero. This is a very important statement, please understand this. They transformed it, changing its role from mere placeholder to a number. This is a very important thing. If you can recall a few names of mathematicians, we had Aryabhata, okay, so a significant person. Any name here?
Bhaskara
Acharya, very good, 12th century. Sridhara Acharya, then? Brahmagupta, okay, very good. This Brahmagupta is the person who actually first discusses in the history of mathematics the operations with zero. It is called a Shunya Parikarma Ashtakam. Okay, so there are basic mathematical arithmetical operations, and discussing with zero is not a simple thing. Okay, so he was the first person who does that, incidentally. So, a number. So, the reincarnation was what gave zero the power. The roots of Indian mathematics are hidden by time. Our numbers, the current system evolved from the symbols that Indians use. By rights, they should be called Indian numerals rather than Arabic ones. Unlike the Greeks, Indians did not see the squares in square numbers or the areas of rectangles when they multiply two different values. Instead, they saw the interplay of numerals. This is a very important statement. Numbers stripped off their geometric significance. If you look at the Greek mathematics, so basically they try to always. So this quadrature of circle is a very interesting problem, you might have seen. So why is it that they are interested? Because they want to transform everything to a certain geometrical object and then only visualize this. This was a problem not only in mathematics, in also astronomy they had a certain constraint, which I will not discuss now. But the point that he is trying to make is a very significant point. So when you try to delink these two, so I can just multiply two numbers and then I do not associate anything with that. This is one level of abstraction with which you move on. Today, I mean, we are moving on towards various abstract levels. And this is one of the most important abstractions. And this is what made Indians come up with algebra. So if you see, this Bhaskaracharya, whom I will mention, Bhaskaracharya has written three important works. One is Leelavati, the other is Bijagarika, and third is Sankrishiromani. So Leelavati primarily deals with geometry and arithmetic. But Bijagarika is exclusively sort of devoted to deal with algebra. So algebra is one level of abstraction that is higher than arithmetic. So this we need to keep. And even when works were translated through the Arabic world, some of Sanskrit works were translated, they left out the chapter on algebra because this was considered to be more complex, it could not be more easily understood. Okay. So that is one aspect which I thought I will just highlight here. Coming to Greek approach, it is stated that Archimedes could be considered as the discoverer of calculus, but then they sort of quickly deny that. The denial is basically because the introduction of the notion of limit was not at all there. Okay, in Archimedes' work, if you see, it is a brilliant work, all that all said and done, but this was not there, and sort of general approach was not there. The notion of limit obviously makes you accept the moving from finite to the infinite domain. Okay, so this was not there, and therefore he could not do that. Okay. Also, there are certain philosophical implications. The notion for infinity is called by the name Aperion, and Aperion was considered to be a negative and pejorative word in the Greek philosophy. And if you look at certain methods which have been adopted by Archimedes, he always returns to this method of reductio ad absurdum, which we call reduction to absurdity. The same problems, so which could be handled so easily with the notion of limit, since the notion of limit was not permissible, had to be done with reductio ad absurdum. I'll give you one simple example, so in which you will be able to appreciate this. So how it simplifies and how it sort of makes it more complicated, with one numerical example, I will show this. For instance, this itself, in trying to find out the volume of a cone or a sort of pyramid kind of a thing, so you have this to sum this infinite geometric series. So 1 by 4 plus 1 by 4 square and so on. So we know that the value is 1 by 3. So he doesn't arrive at the value 1 by 3 the way we do it today, but he had to go to reductio ad absurdum and then come up with that. I'll tell you how Indians did this. So the same problem came in a different context to the Indian mathematicians. This actually occurs in trying to solve the problem of finding out the length of an arc. So imagine a certain circle. The length of the arc will be called as chapa. Chapa or dhanus. Okay. So this problem is something which recurs in various contexts in various ways. So this has to do, in fact, the problem of sine is basically, so when I ask what is sine, so people will say this angle opposite by hypotenuse and all. Essentially, it is basically the problem of finding the relation between arc and the chord of a circle. Okay, that is all it is. Given that, if you know the chord, how will you find out the arc? If you know the arc, how will you find out the chord? This has been a problem with which they have been battling for a long time, and in one context, we find this formula appearing. So the C basically refers to the chord length, and what you find inside the square root is S and J. S is basically shara. Do you have a pointer? Okay, koi baat nahi, idhar dikha rahe. So here, what you find is, shara, you want to find out, this BD is called shara in the figure, and AD is called jya. So S is shara and J is jya. So he finds this interesting relation between this and that. Here, 1 by 3 appears. So how did he get this 1 by 3 and how did it appear in this formula in a very strange way? So here is where Nilakantha had to sum up an infinite geometric series, or even before Nilakantha. Nilakantha was around 1500, so this formula appears even before that, and he tries to sort of explain this. And since there are people from the... very good. Since there are people from the Sanskrit club, so we can also do this. Satyamsha Dishuvarga Yavarangatya Padam Tanupraya. The honor to remember this thing is all there. Satyamsha means along with 1/3. Triamsha means 1/3. Satyamsha means uske saath. Okay? Triamsha ke saath ye ko le lo. Ishuvarga. Ishu is this shara. Shara is this quantity. If you conceive of this part of the circle ABC as bow, then this looks like shara, and that is how the name shara, and this is jya, it is written in the string. And what he says is padam is square root, dhanuhu is that r, okay? Prayaha is approximate, it is not exact result, it is an approximate result. The smaller the value, the better the result will be. But how did he get this 1 by 3? It is an interesting thing. The same result has been arrived. I'll skip a few things. So this is how he seems to have arrived and convinced himself. So please understand. So in this context it appears. Just take the context. How did he know that it is exactly equal? When you think of an infinite series, as you progress in this series, the further terms keep reducing in magnitude. Right? It will keep on reducing. Indefinitely it will keep on reducing. Right? 1 by 4 to the power of 223. So it will keep on decreasing, you can think of 2043. but it is never going to end. It makes some infinitesimal contribution to that. Whatever be the infinitesimal contribution, I have to convince myself as a true mathematician or a scientist that it is definitely going to become zero. The point is, all this will sum, unless you do all the infinite sum, you are not going to get to that point. And if you do that, how are you sure that it is not going to cross that point? So this is the kind of question that one's mind makes one think, right? So this has been beautifully put in this verse, katam punaha tavadeva vartate tavad vartate cha. You can see the rigor. So how do you prove that it definitely reaches that point and it never overshoots that point? When you are making some infinite sum, you may feel that it will reach, but then there should be a way to convince yourself. And here is where this is the kind of explanation that has been offered. Just consider 1 by 3 and you write it as this, 1 by 4 plus. Then consider this term and then you rewrite. So you keep on doing. So when you sum this side and sum the other side, so all of them will cancel. What will remain here is 1 by 3 and what will remain is this geometric sum. Right? Find the difference. So the difference turns out to be this, and now you can argue that as n tends to infinity, right? So this becomes 0. Obviously, you know that. And this, since this becomes 0, this is exactly equal to that. So here, the notion of limit has to be applied, otherwise you will not be able to convince yourself with the answer. So you have to allow this to become infinity, and then you are able to prove yourself. You don't actually do the computation, but you do it in such a way that you convince yourself about the validity of the result. So there is absolute rigor in arriving at this quantity. This is a very interesting thing to note. And this has been beautifully phrased in Sanskrit. Katam punaha tavadeva vartate tavad vartate cha. Definitely it goes to that point and it never overshoots that point. That actually proves. Okay. Normally, when we look at any of the textbooks on history, so people will start with this. These are the two people who are associated with the origin of calculus. This is a very fascinating story of various genius and proficient people, and unfortunately, when it is sort of presented in historical books on history, so this is not something is made clear as to what are the contributions from the other civilizations. This is completely sort of shaped. So it is neither truthful nor complete. Not necessarily because of ignorance, which can be easily controlled or pardoned, but it has to do with something else, which I can elaborate on maybe later. Normally, while speaking of calculus, so these are the two names. Now let us quickly see what are their contributions. Newton was, of course, really a genius, in fact, whose contributions have been immense to various fields. Normally, we know him when we think of gravity and all that, physics definitely. But before he jumped into making some very important discoveries in physics, his mind was working in mathematics. So early Newton actually was working much on mathematics, and his work is called DNRC. So this was in teens when he was in college in Cambridge. He started doing too many things. So expressing some finite quantities as infinite series, this is one of the major contributions which was made by Newton. And he came up with this generalized binomial expansion. And the other thing that he keeps doing is inverting a series. Suppose you have an expression for y in terms of x as a series. Then you want to find out an expression for x in terms of y. So y will turn into infinite series. So this is something which he was able to so easily do, and it requires a certain technique which was developed again by Newton. And in doing this, he has come up with the sine series, which is a remarkable thing. This is very simple for us to understand. We know that the derivative of sine inverse function is 1 by root of 1 minus x square, right? So once you expand this as a series, you have this function, expand this as a series. If you do this, then you sort of invert, what you will get is basically series for sine. You get it? So this is what Newton basically did. So this was a very interesting thing as he was sort of playing around with this, and he arrived at this important series sine. So these are the most important things which are narrated by historians of mathematics as the accomplishments of early Newton. Okay, so when you say early Newton, so before 23, 24, that kind of a thing. But then, he explains the early Newton tends to surpass the mature work of just about anyone else. Okay. So this is a remark which people make about Newton. Now let us come to Leibniz. This Leibniz, the amount of praise that was showered upon Leibniz for discovering this unique phenomenon, as I was mentioning earlier, why? Because it was proved for the first time, okay, that the area of a circle was exactly equal to the series of rational quantities. So it is what it is. When you sort of divide this, this turns out into some beautiful series, okay, so pi by 8. But this is not the series which actually makes it a fast converging series. It is just some rearranging terms kind of a thing. So these two were the signal contributions of Leibniz in this context. Of course, he was a great philosopher and various other things. And was Leibniz the first to discover the series as it is sort of described in the text? Obviously, the answer is no. Right? Grigori was also doing certain things. So this is around the end of 17th century. So he also came up with the series. And William Duncombe, who has written a very interesting book, I would recommend you reading, The Calculus Gallery. Okay, this is the book which he has written. And there he says, but even Grigori was not first down the path. So just before Leibniz, so Grigori had come up with this. So which basically turns to that series. The Indian mathematician Neelakanta, whom we met in the previous chapter, in a work called Tantra Sangraha, is what he says. In fact, both are wrong. Neelakanta is associated with Tantra Sangraha, that is true. But Neelakanta does not do this series. So Neelakanta was around 1500. So this series actually goes back to Madhava, who was around 1350, 1360 kind of a thing. But why did this man, Duncombe, make a serious mistake? So this mistake was basically because somebody else called Ranjan Roy. So unhone ek article likhiya. He is a discovery of the series formula by Leibniz, Grigori and Neelakanta. So mathematical practice in 1980. So isko lekar ke unhone aisa kaha gaya. So at least there has been some recognition. We 2-3 years back, somebody came to IIT. So he wanted to interview a few of us relating to history of Indian mathematics. I gave an audience, and after this was over, he was basically from England. So there was some BBC news or something like that. He handed over a book to me, and then he went off as a sort of gift. So later, when I flipped through the book, I find this series appearing. Okay? The one minus one by three and so on. And he says, Leibniz was the first ruler. No other mention of anybody else. This is certainly not out of ignorance. So this has been floating around in the West since 1835. So if one were to say, make any statement, so regarding the founder of the series, so he has to be truthful to history. So this is not out of ignorance, but certain other factors also figure into. So in trying to present the history. So this, you just keep in mind, I just want to caution you that we should not just take things for granted as it is which appears, okay? Okay, so I will skip this also. This binomial series expansion, which you find, is a very interesting thing. It is a very interesting contribution of Newton, we saw. But this arises in a completely different way in Indian mathematics. The binomial series. So they just consider a term of this kind, but then they turn out into an infinite series. Okay, I will tell you why they were discussing a problem of this type. Just consider one A, B and C. One is called Gunya, the other is called Gunaka, the other is called Hara. Okay? Gunya, Gunaka, multiplier, multiplication and divisor. Just consider this. And they are turning this expression, as it is A, B by C, into a sort of infinite series. So the point is, expanding some finite quantity as an infinite sum. This itself is a great game in mathematics. Okay? So this was something which was successfully done by Newton. And one may think that it complicates the problem, but it actually helps you in trying to solve various problems. I am going to give you one illustration in the context of the derivation of the series of pi. So they started with this, and then you can express it in either of the way. So depending upon whether C is greater than B or C is less than B, and then they went on, and then they came up with the series of this kind. So A into B by C, as you can see. So this can be put in the form of a binomial expansion also. I am just leaving that, but I just want to draw your attention that they were playing around with this kind of a
series.
Now I move on to discuss about why in the series. Aryabhata has given this verse. Chaturadhikam shatam ashtagunam dvashashtis tatha sahasranam ayutadvaya vishkambhasya asanno vritta parinaha. Vritta parinaha, vritta is circle, parinaha is circumference. So this value is equal to this. Chaturadhikam shatam 104, ashtagunam is multiplied by 8, dvashashtis tatha sahasranam 62,000. Ayutadvaya vishkambha. Vishkambha means diameter. Ayuta is 10,000. Ayutadvaya is 2 × 10,000. Asanno vritta parinaha. This amounts to this value. And later, if you see in the Indian mathematical tradition, we find this verse appearing. Vibhuta netra gajadi kutasana triguna veda bhavarana vahavaha nava nikharva mite vriti vistare parikimanam idam jagadur budhaha. So this actually gives you this. This series, this expression for pi, is given by Madhavacharya. Okay? Madhavacharya punaha aha. You understand? The Madhava whom I was referring to in the 14th century. So this verse that is written to Madhava. We don't find the words of Madhava, but people have quoted. How is this number given? Vibhuta is 33. Netra is 2. Okay, this is called Bhuta Sankhya system. There are different systems which have been adopted by Indian mathematicians to represent numerals. So this notation 1, 2, 3 that we use today came much, much, much later. This itself is one level of abstraction. You know how many entities, you find some word to express that. So you may have a word to represent 2, 3. You may have a notation to represent 2, 3. So now you use binomial, right? 0, 1, that kind of a thing, you do that. There are various ways in which you can do that. So here they use this thing. Why are they interested in expressing like this? Because they are putting everything in the form of verses. So for verse, you have to meet some metrical requirements, and there should be a very easy way of handling things. So they invented a very beautiful system called Bhuta Sankhya. Gaja, Ahi, Kutasana. Kutasana means fire, so it occurs in 3. 3 is 3, Guna is 3, Veda is 4, and so on. Okay? So this is how, but this is correct to 11 decimal places. The, right to left. So it is a convention. They always start with the least decimal place and then move to the most decimal place. This is one system. There are other systems in which you can move, but this is how they usually put it. There is also a certain convenience in doing this. So if you want to sort of do this, so sometimes you can find a word which actually sums two things. So it can be 27, it can be 30, 32. So if you want to sort of add certain things in using the system, so it can be a certain convenience. So this is how they do. And this is correct to 11 decimal places. So one really wonders as to how. Yes, please.
So what is the context for Madhavacharya to come up with this fraction?
Yeah. See, this is very good. Why were they interested? In other words, do you mean to ask me whether this kind of accuracy was needed in finding certain things?
Yeah.
Okay. So this sort of accuracy, in principle I would say, may not be essential for any kind of computation which you are able to do. Because there are certain other inaccuracies which also come into picture. But wherever you can be as accurate as possible, you would like to do. So given any device, there are certain inaccuracies which may anyway come into. But wherever it is possible, you would like to act. So this actually comes indirectly in the calculation of sine function. So this is how they do it. So this basically, this is a very beautiful thing. So whether you call it the ratio of circumference to diameter, or you call it the relation between arc and the chord, so it amounts to one and the same thing. So if you are able to represent this precisely, obviously you will be able to compute sine precisely. Sine is something which is ubiquitous in all your calculations, and therefore he wants to go and find out as accurately as possible. And it could be a sort of mathematical curiosity also. So, this is another thing. Okay, the point is, there are two things to be noted here. One is, how could one get this accurate value? Rather to is he says jagadur budha. Jagaduku means stated. Budhaha means wise people. So wise people say this is the value. So this makes me wonder whether Madhava himself came up with the series or somebody else gave this value. This also is not known. But this is the verse which is quoted. Okay. It is well known that Madhava arrived at this value because of other things which are available in the stature using this series only. This is also ascribed to Madhava. Vyasa Varini Hate. I was quoting this before. Vyasa is diameter, Varini is circumference. Varini Hate. Varini is ocean. So continents are surrounded by water, four sides, therefore it is taken to the question. Four. Rupa Hate, Vyasa Sagarabhi Hate, Tri Sarabhi, Vishana Sankhya, Bhaktam, Rinam, Swam. Okay, Rinam is negative, Swam, Prithak, Kramat, Surya. We keep on going. So this is basically the verse which gives the infinite series, which is normally ascribed to livings. Okay, which is what I stated before. How did they arrive at it? So this is a very interesting thing. I'll just give you an example of where the concept of differentiation is carrying all this time in speech. This is just a very simple construction. Think of 1/4 of a circle. Okay? So this is what it is. Then you split this side, which is basically the radius of the circle, into n parts. So then consider a couple of triangles. So O, A, I, this is AI, and this you drop perpendicular from that point to this point. So these are the two triangles which are sort of similar. Let me just quickly, without getting into the details, by considering a couple of right angle triangles which are similar to each other, what you try to do is you try to arrive at an expression for AIBI. AIBI is basically the chord. You arrive at an exact expression for this. Then, as n increases, you argue that the chord length is basically the arc length. You sort of sum up and then you come up with the series. So, this is the overall technique that has been employed. So, that is the idea. And the argument that is given is in Sanskrit, parihi khandasya ardhatya parityam cha eva. This is what we call as modern terminology, local approximation by linear function. Okay? Parihi khanda is a small segment of the circumference. Ardhatya is basically the chord. Parityam cha eva. It is same as the parihi arc itself. Okay? When n becomes large. So this is the kind of thing. And then you try to do the summation. What you basically get is this expression, and then you have to sum up. In this, r is the radius, n is the number of divisions, and this ki and ki minus 1 basically are the hypotenuses of these triangles. Okay, opi minus 1 is ki minus 1, and opa is ki. So these are the quantities which appear. There is absolutely no approximation involved in this. This is the exact expression. After arguing this, he will say that you have computed essentially a small portion of the segment, then you have to increase from 1 to n, then you will get the whole arc. So this is all it is. And there comes this series. So how do you compute this? So as n increases, you can always say that the two karnas, the k, k minus 1, the hypotenuses, are so close to each other that you can approximate either this end or that end. Right? So you do that. But then you also have to show that as n becomes large, this tends to 0. Mathematically rigorously. So this also is shown. So you will see that. And the difference is whether you approximate it as k0 square or you approximate it as k1 square, you have to basically do the summation. And the difference is this. Then you can straight away see. See, this is where I am just saying the notion of limit was so clear to them, and they were saying as n tends to infinity. So this is not proved by reduction to absurdity as it is done in Archimedes. So all these arguments will be proved by reduction to absurdum by Archimedes. But here they clearly argue. So n becomes infinity, this becomes 0, therefore this is exactly that. Having done all this argument, they will say, see, tadantarantu shunya prayameva. See, you understand the term? Shunya praya is almost 0. But when n becomes infinity, it becomes 0. You are okay? So that is the point. And for large n, how to actually do the summation? This turns out that that's what I was saying. See, a into b by c kind of a thing, and you write it as some infinite series. in order to evaluate this, so the explicit has increased, and when you sort of loop the term, it just amounts to, so if you look at this expression, if you pull this r by n out, what you get is 1 square plus 2 square plus and so on plus n square, then 1 to the power 4 plus 2 to the power 4, n to the power 4, 1 to the power 6, 2 to the power 6 and so on. So you get, basically this boils down to summing up these squares of natural numbers, 4th power of natural numbers, 6th power of natural numbers and so on and so forth. You have to have a mechanism as to how you do. So this is what is called Sankalita in Sanskrit. Varga Sankalita, Varga Varga Sankalita and so on and so forth. So what I do is, when n is large, how do you obtain this? A certain rigorous way by which they have evaluated this, and they say, the result I just quote, so they have sort of shown that it goes through n to the k plus 1 by k plus 1, and when you substitute this, you will get this series. Okay? So this is all that is involved in trying to arrive at this infinite series, which is ascribed to Grigori normally. Grigori, and this is the Indian way of doing. This is an extremely slowly converging series. I just want to give you a flavor how to actually make it fast convergent. Turn a slowly convergent series into a fast convergent series. There is an ingenious way by which they have done, and what he says is, if you are feeling bored at any point of time in computing this series, usko vahi rakho, doesn't matter where you stop. Okay? The term that they use for boredom is jamita. See? Jamitaya. Do you find that? In Sanskrit club people, jamita means boredom. Okay? He says, yat sankhyatra harane prate. When you keep dividing this series, you may get bored. Kya hai, dil karna hai, add karna hai, kuch bhi nahi aata. Okay? So, tab usko vahi band karo. This operation has to be stopped there. Okay, he says, nivritta hrtistu jamitaya. Then he says, what you have to do is, suppose you terminate the series at P. Okay, P is some odd number. Then you have to decide where you have stopped, whether it is plus sign or minus sign. So do that, and the rest of the series will be estimated based on the P. Otherwise the method will not work. You understand? Anywhere you stop means, so unless you give an algorithm by which you will be able to determine the rest of the series based on where you have stopped. So this is a very beautiful analysis which they have done, and he gives a few expressions for estimating the rest of the series. There are different orders in which he has given. So it is a very nice algorithm. I am not going to explain that, but I wanted to convey that it is a very beautiful analysis which has been done, which does not lack any kind of rigor that we try to impose in today's mathematics. So he says, then if you do that, labdhaha parijihi sukshmaha. So you terminate the series, evaluate the rest of the terms, add that to this, and add or subtract depending on where you stop. So you will get a very accurate value. This is what he says. And there is a nice analysis which is done. So we will skip all this. I just gave you a flavor of how it is done. All that you do is you make some error estimates and then you try to minimize the error. Today it may be called as minimization, okay? Error minimization technique. I mean, this is all you can call it in modern terms. All that has been nicely argued and explained. So once you do that, see, look at this graph. There are two orders for which I have shown this graph. So in one order, you see that the error starts from this and then it goes like this. So there are the n here refers to the number of terms in the series, in the transformed series that you will consider. Okay, you take n and then you can put it in the form of a series, or you can simply have the series and then evaluate and then add. Both ways it can be done. So good to be done both ways. So you do this, consider 40 terms in the series, and what you will get is, you will get the value which is correct to 11 decimal places. Okay. So the transformation of an excruciatingly slowly converging series into a fast converging series. So this has also been done by Madhava. And this is one simple example. So where this is the expression which is given to evaluate sine function. By Aryabhata himself it was given. So they have been doing a lot of recursive operations. So earlier, in order to compute sine function, where do you go? you don't have the series. This series was discovered only in 14th century. But till then, you should have some kind of a table. So people used to memorize the sign value in the form of verses. So some 24 values will be memorized, 0 to 90. If you want to find out some intermediate value, then you do first order interpolation or second order interpolation, you do various things. So to do this, I mean, there are different ways in which people have attempted to compute, and one of the brilliant ways which Aryabhata has done in 499 is analytic relation, a nice relation. In fact, this is when I was giving lecture in Chennai Mathematical Institute, which was organized at the instance of Mumford in 2008. So Mumford is a Fields Medalist, many of you may not know, he is one of the most senior and highly respected Fields Medalists. So he was seriously interested in the history of mathematics, and therefore he told the director that we organized two talks. So myself and a few others, even the Rodhamas, we gave it two talks. So he was really thrilled when I was presenting this Aryabhata's method. I did not have the confidence to declare that this is basically the discrete version of the harmonic equation. But Mumford immediately jumped and then said, oh, this is the discrete version of the harmonic equation. When I say harmonic equation, you know, d square by dx square, basically. So that is the kind of thing. So this is really remarkable, which Aryabhata did. And I will skip this, but I just wanted to tell you. And this is commented by D'Alembert. He says, the method is curious. It indicates the method of calculating the table of signs by means of the second differences. Okay? The differential process has not up to now been employed except by Briggs, who himself did not know the constant factor. And finally, he says, it was found neither amongst Greeks nor amongst Arabs. Okay? So this is the only technique which the Western world has accepted as originally Indian. Okay. This is the verse which actually gives you the sign series. Nihatya chapa vargena chapam tattva tavancha. Chapa is arc. How do you represent in modern notation? R theta. Okay. Chapa varga is R theta square. Nihatya means having multiplied. Having multiplied R theta by R theta square. Okay. So you get R theta cube. So your first term is R theta. Next term is R theta cube. Usko fir R theta square se multiply karo. So keep on doing. You will get all the R powers of R theta. Okay. So this is basically the sign series. You can see this. So all the R powers of R theta come. Nihatya chapa vargena chapam tattva tavancha means the result that you get previous step. Every time you multiply by R theta square. Then harayat means divide. Samura yugvargai, you basically need the factorial in the denominator. So 3 factorial, 5 factorial and so on. The 3 factorial is 2 square plus 2. Okay. Then 5 factorial will be 2 square plus 2 into 4 square plus 4. This is one way of writing. Okay. So you keep, that is what he is saying. Samura yugvarga. Yug means even number. Varga is square. Samura means the base. So you square is considered as an operation. You have some number and the squaring is an operation of that. Samula means with the base. So 2 plus 2 square, 4 plus 4 square. This will be the denominator and you will get all the factorial in the denominator. And if he says keep one below the other, keep subtracting, you will get the sign series. So this is how it is written in the form of verses. So this is the verse which basically gives you, you take it for granted from me, that it gives you the derivative of sine inverse function precisely. So last few slides, couple of slides. So what I was trying to tell you was, there are certain interesting results which have been found in completely different way and expressed in the form of verses or in the form of some prose in the text. Okay? So which are considered to be the foundations of calculus or mathematical analysis, and this is found in Kerala school very rigorously. Of course, Bhaskaracharya in 14th century, he came up with statements like, suppose there is a curve which has a peak, so then d by dx becomes 0. So all this is stated by Bhaskara. But in a full-fledged full-blown form, you find them in Kerala school. So as I also showed that how to convert a slowly converting series into a rapidly converting, this has been done, and the techniques by which they did, certain things are clear and evident to us, but certain things are not. They have also given not only the derivative of sine inverse x, but how to find derivative of two functions. Suppose you have a function u, you have a function v, if you want to find the derivative, the expressions are clear, but then how did they arrive at it? The process, the methodology has been adopted to arrive at a general form. That is not clear because everything is sort of put in the form of verses. Sometimes we find commentary, sometimes we don't find commentary. If you find commentary, we can break our head and then try to understand much deeper. But if it is not there, it is all the more difficult. So, these are usually ascribed to Madhava, all these fundamental results, whether it is this pi series or sine series or cosine series, they are ascribed to Madhava. But unfortunately, we do not have the works of Madhava available to us. So it is all from the citations that we understand that it is Madhava's work. Mumford, I was mentioning before, this proceedings of the conference was brought out and the talks. So there he writes, as a preface, in the preface he writes, only a fraction of this. By this I mean, he describes all the Kerala work and free Kerala work and all that. He says, has become generally known, not known to mathematicians in the West. Too many people still think that mathematics was born in Greece and more or less slumbered until Renaissance. Renaissance is around 15th, 16th century. So there was absolutely nothing in the European continent done after Ptolemy. Almost for 14 centuries, nothing was done. And that is why he calls it as slumbered. Okay? So from 2nd century to 14th, 15th century. It is right time. So this is a very, very long review has been written by Mumford, to a work by Kim Plofker on mathematics in India. Review can be written in 2 pages, it can be written in 10 pages. But he chose to write review, a long review of almost 10 to 12 pages, Mumford, for this work. And towards the end, he sort of says, it is right time that the full story of Indian mathematics from Vedic times, 2600, became generally known. I am not minimizing the genius of Greeks and their wonderful invention of pure mathematics, but other people have been doing math in different ways. Okay, so this we need to understand. So this is not at all made known. I myself admit that till I completed my MSc Physics, I never knew a single name of Indian mathematician. At least you said Bhaskara or Aryabhata and so on. Wo bhi mujhe nahi pata tha. Okay. So incidentally, I was drawn into it and I got stuck. Okay. So this is what he says, doing mathematics in different ways. So the way Leibniz arrived at it is completely different from the way I showed as to how this series was derived. Okay. They were doing different ways. And they have often attained the same goal independently. Rigorous mathematics in the Greek style should not be seen as the only way to gain mathematical knowledge. So finally he says the use of mathematics can be moved in many different ways and the secrets is out of that. Okay? So this is the way he concludes the review, and if you are interested in mathematics, better read that. Okay. Here I want to quote this interesting historian, Todd Allers. He says, so this statement may amuse you, all history is elaborate efforts in myth-making. Okay? Why does he say? I mean, after all, we have to construct certain facts, right? So what happened 1500 years, we get some tidbits of information, from that we try to construct history. So it is in this sense he is making the statement. And then he says, if we must continue to live with it, it is far better we choose to live with those of our own making rather than invented by others for their own purposes. So that much we owe at least as an independent society. This is the final slide. So we all know that Manjul Bhargava received a Fields Medal, right? Last year. You should be knowing. So he is the first Indian mathematician, or rather mathematician of Indian origin. So he was asked this question, I think this is what was shown before also. Why is still India mid-power in mathematics despite its famed legacy? This famed legacy, first of all, is not known, right? So, kitne ko pata hai? So we don't even know any of the discoveries which they sort of try to discover, which are considered to be fundamental. Therefore, he says, students in India should be taught about great ancient Indian mathematicians like Panini, Pingala, Hemachandra, Aryabhata and Bhaskara. The Panini is that here? Yoga Sutra of Patanjali. How did he use Mahesha Sutra? Mahesha Sutra are just 14 sutras, whereas he read what is known as Akshadhari. अष्टाध्यायी में कितने सूत्र होते हैं? एक चैप्टर कितने सूत्र? इट इज 4000. ओके, सो 4000 सूत्र इन एट चैप्टर्स. द ट्रेडिशनल वे ऑफ स्टडिंग अष्टाध्यायी इज टू मेक द चाइल्ड मेमोराइज ऑल द 4000 सूत्र. No, it is essential. No, this is not a big task at all. See, both of these can be printed in 80 pages and cost maybe a little more better. So the 80 page memorization is nothing. That people can memorize 800 pages. So all these Vedas chanting, I mean, see, the faculty that we have is something which we do not understand. The potential that we have is really enormous. So amazing are the mind's talents. There are people I know who can tell what is the first line in the text in all the pages. So it's a fantastic performance. My own cousin brother, when he was learning Veda, I was really astonished. He will say every page, from 340 pages, first sentence on the page. I mean, the capacity is really enough. But anyway, the point is, these sutras have been constructed in such a way that you want to use as minimal space as required. Even a letter should not be redundant. I mean, that is the way he has done that. But the question that I asked was, why did Manjul say Pani? What did Vyakaran say? What did Mathematics say? Mathematics is a combination. I tell you, since you said Mahesh, you said Maheshwara Sutra. This Maheshwara Sutra is set of 14 sutras. Anybody who knows that? I won't really am on my house. Okay, what does it do? It basically lists the character set in Sanskrit. Correct? The character set in Sanskrit has been listed, vowels and consonants. They have been listed in the Kama Sutra. But why 14 sutras? Why not 12 sutras? Why not 16 sutras? This is a question which has been posed by a very bright electrical engineer, I think from Germany or somebody. I saw an interesting paper. She posed this question as a sort of game theory kind of thing. The question is this the only optimal way of listing out all the consonants? A beautiful paper, around 10-15 pages. So she finally comes to the conclusion that this is the optimal way. You understand? So in some sutra you may find some 5 characters listed, in some other sutra only 3 characters listed, some sutra only 1 character listed. So you have to first define what you are going to do with them. So then you have to construct in such a way and club them. This seems to have been the game theory that has been played with Panini in arriving at sutra as we understand today. Okay? So that is why the Manjul tells Panini, this first Panini, and then Pindara of course matrix is in our play, which he himself talked about in one or two places. And then of course Aryabhata, Bhaskara. But he has stopped with Bhaskara. The Bhaskara he referred to here is the 12th century Bhaskara. There was another Bhaskara who was in 6th century, with whose grace they are able to understand Aryabhatiya. Otherwise, Aryabhatiya is just printed in one A4 sheet. Okay, 108 verses. But it deals with mathematics, it deals with astronomy, it deals with sphere and all that. There are 3 padas. But utna test likh diya, bahut takleef usko samajhne mein, dimag kharab ho jayega. So that is what this Aryabhata did anyway. He found his own way of representing numbers also. One single syllable, 10 to the power 17. Okay, so he chose the vowels to represent the digit. Okay, so it was a centesimal system, I would say. We deal with decimal system. Unhone aisa kuch kar diya. Anyway, the Aryabhata and Bhaskara is one of the mathematicians. He did not refer to the Kerala mathematicians whom I talked about now. Okay, who came up with the infinite series. And then he finally says many of these works. See, he says, it inspired me and I believe they would inspire students across India. Many of these works are written in Indian languages, which would poetry. And some of these are very important ways to understanding history of mathematics. So this Manjul's quotation, okay, so is quite interesting, and I conclude my talk with that quotation. That we should.
Session is open for questions.
Yes.
Please, Dr. Mishra.
Is there any reference for representation of pi as infinite products? Is it infinite series?
Reference as infinite product?
I mean, analog of sine x over x as a product 1 minus x squared over n squared pi squared.
No, I is not done as a product, it is only written as part of theme. You don't have. There's never. Because intuitively it is much easier to get a very large
number upstairs and downstairs to multiply things. So, in that sense, I believe that, you know, the slide that you've shown, which had very large numbers, like, and something like 10 to 11.
Okay.
So, isn't it plausible that it could have been gotten by a product, as an infinite product? I think there's something called a Wallis product, if I remember
right. Correct.
So, some analog of that.
You have a Wallis product is there, but they didn't cut up that way. So, this pi was independently done in connection with determining the trigia, what they call, which will be used in evaluating sine product. So that is how it came.
Any other question? Please. Rishabh Jha.
If you walk into a bookstore, you can't really ask for an Aryabhatiya or some Sanskrit word of other these people. Where exactly do you get such stuff?
Yeah.
What sort of people?
It is very unfortunate that neither the history is perfected in normal course of our curriculum, nor do we find these texts. These texts are available in certain specific stores where you get some oriental books. Okay, there are some special shops. But there too, so we don't find good editions. And what you may find is a text with Sanskrit commentary, which is usually taught in traditional pathshalas. Aryabhatiya, for instance, we have only one good work, which is done by Prof. K. Shukla of Lucknow University. It was brought out for the first time in 1976. So when 1500th anniversary of Aryabhata was celebrated. But the issue is, where is the market? So neither the libraries are interested, nor the students are interested, nor the general public is interested. I mean, it's not the situation 2 years ago. So now it is slowly changing over the past 10 12 years. Some awareness is being created. And unless we sort of present these things, make people aware, it is extremely difficult for people to take interest. Unless they take interest, nothing is going to go. So this is a problem. That is why Manju's statement is very relevant. Make students aware. This is a very important thing, I would say, because it inspires people. Without our knowledge, we feel very happy. I was very happy when I came to know about all this and I started learning about this. So some of these techniques may be useful, and in fact, one of the lecturers was saying that he was sort of inspired for which the Nobel Prize was given to one of the principles which is called Bhavana principle, expressed by Ramasubramanian. It is one of the very useful principles, and that actually he says that it inspired him to think along a particular way to come up with this. What may be useful, what may not be useful, to find out something new is a different issue. But learning something which has been done in a completely different way is itself exciting in its own.
Sir?
Yes.
As you mentioned that Ms. Madhva's uses
for converts in the case of pi, means p plus 1 by 2 divided by p plus 1 by 2 whole square plus and so on. So, do it capital and other places also to convert any series?
So, I would say that whether this method is applicable or not is the question. I would say if you look at it from a general perspective, it amounts to a technique which may be called as error minimization technique. And therefore, I would say in principle it is applicable. The method is applicable. But the way you have to employ may vary from series to series. No, it is applicable for that series.
For
that series. See, they always try to find a problem and solution to that problem. So this is one thing which you may find in the Indian scenario generally. Okay? A specific problem is relevant to you to work out the solution for.
Because they are related.
So
some of the things might have gone to East
Europe from India. Yeah. So this is a sort of question which is very difficult to answer, whether there was sort of transmission from here to the other places. I would say categorical yes. possible to, whether this mathematics which I discussed today was practical or not, which I will not be able to vouchsafe. And it has been a certain hypothesis which has been put forth by a very brilliant mathematician called C.K. Raju. In fact, he has written a text, The Cultural History of Mathematics, where he discusses at great length. All said and done, the first time when Europeans came to India, particularly to Kerala, towards the end of 1850, 1498, Vasco da Gama started his expedition and he came here. So having come here, something would have gone, but we do not have textual evidences to prove that. And therefore, anything that is being stated can be only utmost speculative. And this actually created a lot of commotion in the area, and Kerala actually turned into a bloodshed within a year. So then Dutch came, they too were fighting, and the scenario was terrible. Not conducive for any more intellectual activity. This is what happened. So we don't have concrete evidence.
But you see, connection is there. I have a police friend. He was saying there are many words which are common between Poland, Polish and
Yeah, words could be common, but as far as this context is concerned, I would not say.
We should teach history, at least mathematics history, to students somewhere. How we lost, even people don't know about Brahmagupta.
True, very true. See,
has it been in any other country? They would have got much, much more.
Absolutely. So if you look at any of the history of science texts, hundreds and hundreds are being written. Literally, maybe even thousands. But unfortunately,
whatever they have done in Europe, you go, there is a replica or some statue of the person.
Correct.
There is history
in
the name of the mathematician or
scientist. That is why I am saying. So these are all celebrated. But here, unfortunately, for whatever reason, it is not evident.
Maybe
he is. Yeah, so I don't want to get it. I mean, they sort of try to deal in various things. So, that is, I tell you an important, interesting story. Since you said this, this series which I am talking about, the Madhava series and all, for the first time, it was written in the form of an article by Charles Bish, who was an East Indian Company employee here. Charles, which was posted in Kerala in 1820s, he developed interest, connection with these people, learned about all these series, different series, and then comes up with an article in early 1820s, 23-24. He actually writes this to his senior official that I found an interesting series and so on and so forth. It goes without saying that he had to struggle for almost 10 years. For the first time, it ever gets published in 1834. And the correspondence also we were able to find out, where the senior officer bluntly refused, saying that this could not have been done by them. They should have simply copied from there, and it is no way that they would have arrived at this scene. There is a lot of interesting correspondence which goes on. And this lower class servant could not convince for about 10 years, and finally, the paper gets published in 1834. Let us keep the story there. From 1834 till 1940-1950, we will not find any single textbook discussing about this. Even after that, as I told you, this man in 2010, when he gives me a copy of his book published in 2009 or so, he doesn't want to acknowledge. This is what I said. There is much more deep history. Why he was not made more? More than ignorance of Sanskrit knowledge.
Last question. As you have said, most of these things are written in verse.
Yeah.
Now, because we have already some knowledge, we are trying to reverse engineer and find out what is written in verses. But is it what I mean? One has to go over the original knowledge of mathematics, then only one can discover if there is something new in verses. Or everything is discovered by now.
No.
Or there is something new in all the Sanskrit.
Wait. See, is there something which is not known to other mathematics than Sanskrit, which is described in Sanskrit? This is not true. I mean, most of the things are quite well known and we have gone ahead with various forms of that. But the only thing that is interesting here is the approach, the methodology. So as I gave an example, Manjul himself recognizes that this sort of gave me some idea to work in some domain. So therefore, the method completely differs, and therefore it is possible. Number two, as citizens of a particular nation, they are bound to know what has been done in their own nation. If at all one has to have some sort of self-esteem and some sort of confidence in what it is undertaking. Okay, this will actually build. I'll give you an example. I went to Beijing 3-4 times over the past 5-6 years. What I found strange there was, strategically over the past 3 decades, they have made every citizen of China know their own science and technology. What was done? Today, not a single student can come out of the college having a degree in medicine without undergoing 2-3 courses on Chinese medicine. No engineer can come out without knowing what their technological innovations were. So this, I would say, is one of the reasons. I mean, that is why the statement is very clear that we should make people aware of their own achievements. It is not to boast saying that I mean, we were the first to do all this, etc., etc. But this actually, psychologically, plays a role. Otherwise, you always feel that I mean, they have done this, they have done this, we have been only slaves. Let us be slaves. So this, I think, is very important.
Okay, I thank Sanskrit Club and particularly Gauri Shetty for inviting me to deliver a talk.
धन्यवाद रामसुब्रमण्यन महोदय. सो डे बिफोर यस्टरडे देयर वाज अ कॉन्फ्रेंस, नेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑन ट्रेडिशनल नॉलेज एंड कॉन्टेम्पररी इनोवेशंस. इन द इनॉग्रल फंक्शन प्रोफेसर अशोक मिश्रा वाज देयर एज ए चीफ गेस्ट एंड ही डिलीवर्ड अ लेक्चर इन विच ही मेंशन वेरी क्लियरली दैट नाउअडेज व्हेनेवर वी टॉक अबाउट ट्रेडिशनल नॉलेज एंशिएंट दीज थिंग्स अनफॉर्चुनेटली डिस्कशन रिवॉल्व्स अराउंड फिलोसॉफी रिलीजन or some kind of history, all those things, politics. So now it is a high time to come out of this kind of framework. And he has, you know, categorized, at least he made 8 categories in science and 8 branches in technology, in which especially places like IITs should work. So I personally thank Professor Ashok Mishra, Chairman, Board of Governors, IIT Roorkee, for his personal involvement in establishing this Sanskrit Club. So my vote of thanks starts with thanking Professor Ashok Mishra. Then thanks to our director, because of some unavoidable reasons, he could not come today as chief guest. Then all the deans and the Department of Physics for allowing us to utilize this facility. And Bhavantaha Sarve, Manah Purvaka, Dhanyavadaha. Thanks to one and all. Namo Namaha.